Hi everyone, welcome back to my channel. This is the Parenting We Love podcast. My name is Bemi Shola. I'm your host for this podcast. And today I'm going to be talking about what does it mean to parent with calm and why is it important for us to parent with calm as parents. So, welcome back guys. As I said earlier, today is about why is it important and what does it mean to parent with calm. I'm going to be sharing you three reasons why it's important for us as parents to be calm while we're parenting. So looking at the dictionary, it says that being calm means to have a peaceful mental or emotional state. So to be in a peaceful mental or emotional state, to be free from agitation, excitement or disturbance. And it also means a quiet and peaceful state of emotion. I think that they're basically saying the same thing. To be in a place where we're quiet and peaceful and where we're free from agitation. Of course, we all know that different things happen every day. You know, it depends on the ages of your children, whether you have teenagers, toddlers, you know, different things that can agitate us or can excite us, right? But peaceful parenting is about being in a place where we are being guided by wisdom. And being guided by God. And the Bible says that those who are led by the Spirit are the sons of God, not by our emotions. I'm sure it has happened to us several times where you do something where you are upset or where you're even excited, like, and then when you are calm, you regret doing that thing because you feel like, oh, why didn't I wait? You know? So peaceful parenting is about, you know, not just jumping to do things. And one way the Bible says is be quick to listen, be slow to speak. Like being slow, there's no prize, there's no trophy in being quick to do things. Or, you know, there was a time when I think that if I don't do it now, like something will happen, or that it means I'm a terrible parent. No, in fact, you'll be more in charge and in control, and you'll be a wise person if you pause before trying to do anything, right? So it's not going to make your children, in fact, our children learn from what we do. They learn how to regulate their emotions by watching us. So when they see that, oh, mommy is upset, but she's not lashing out or she's taking a pause. And we can also use this and an opportunity to teach them, oh, this is what happened to me. Mommy was upset the other time, but I didn't want to talk while I was upset. And so I waited to calm down. I'm not angry with you, but I'm angry with this thing that you did. You know, we can use it to have this conversation. So that's the definition of what it means to parent with calm. So why do we need to parent with calm? I said I'm going to share three reasons. Number one is it's difficult to build in chaos. It's difficult to build in crisis. It's difficult to build in a disaster. Imagine if someone is trying to build in a war zone. If there's a war going on and then someone decides that's when I want to go and build my house. How possible is that? Even if he tries, even if he succeeds, even if he succeeds in doing the foundation, maybe he has guards, a bomb can just come from anywhere and destroy that thing. That's what happens when we parent from a state of agitation, when our homes and the atmosphere in our houses look like war zone all the time. I want us to evaluate ourselves. Looking at our houses, does it look like a chaotic zone? Does it look like a disaster zone? Does it look like war is going on all the time? Are we always yelling and shouting and screaming? Because what is going to happen is, even if we manage to do some building, remember I said, even if you manage to build a little, what will happen is the next minute, because we are not being calm or we are not being wise, we're going to pull down that thing that we built ourselves, right? So number one thing is, it's difficult to build well. It's difficult to build properly. Even if we end up building anything, we may end up destroying it in the same vein, right? I know that a lot of adults in my generation have to go through therapy now, or those who don't even realize are dealing with things because, yes, there was some building that happened, but a lot of damage was also done. And so we don't want that to happen. Okay, so number two, you know, the Bible says that train up your child in the way that it should go. So every time all we do is yell and scream and shout, we are training them that that is the way they should go. We are training them that that's the normal way to deal with conflict. We are training them that when they see something that they don't like, they should start yelling and screaming, and that they can even beat the person up. That's what we are teaching them. You know, we are teaching them that. We're not teaching them how to have conversations. We're teaching them you know, being self-centered, because sometimes the reasons why we yell as parents is just basically selfish reasons, just because the child is not fitting into your own expectation. And parenting is not about us. It's not about our likes, dislikes, or your child may have a different personality from you. The child cannot be you. It's not about you. We are giving these children to God and steward them in the way that they should go, in the way that they are. We are meant to live with them in understanding, understand who your child is, understand their personality. Based on the understanding of who they are and the wisdom that we have, we are meant to guide and teach them and correct them and discipline them. But remember that a lot of what we do, children see us and they hear us. They do the two. I know sometimes people say children see us more than they hear us. They actually do the two. They hear us and they see us. And so anytime we are always in that war zone, we are teaching them that that's how to behave. That's why people grow up and they are leaders of organizations and they really don't have emotional intelligence. They don't know how to talk to people that are below them because they feel that power is used to terrorize people, right? But that's not the example that Jesus gave us. You know, Jesus talked about serving. You know, we need being able to model that leadership power, because the truth is we're actually in a position of power over our children. It's a place of love, service, correction, guidance, right? Gracefully. So that's number two. Number three is that we are kingdom parents and we represent the king. We are representing our king. So I want to ask us, in our everyday life, what we do as parents, we're not representing how we grew up. We're not representing our ideas. Remember that in the kingdom, Jesus said, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself. We have to deny ourselves, our ideas. If our culture is clashing with God's word, we need to drop it. We can't keep holding on and saying, this is what they did to me. This is what they did for me. This is what I'm used to. Truly following Christ is about letting go of whatever it is that isn't in line with his word, because we represent the king. Sincerely, the family is that structure that God has created to propagate his kingdom, to propagate his ideas, to propagate his nature, which is love, mercy, grace, right? So we represent the king in our houses, and that's the third reason why we need to parent to come. Jesus is our perfect example. Like, when I look at him in the scriptures, things were happening, but he wasn't disturbed. There was a storm, he was sleeping, right? He knew that his disciples were going to betray him and deny him, but he didn't go into a rage. He didn't go into a fit, you know. The prodigal son's father, the guy said, oh, I want my inheritance. The guy didn't start raking and screaming. He said, okay, take it and go. And he was waiting for him with loving arms. You know, another example I saw is Genesis, when man fell, you know, after God said, gave them their punishment, Bible says he clothed them. He wasn't out of control. Love was always the foundation of everything he did. You know, some of us in that moment we won't carry all the leaves and all the goats so that the child will not have any clothes to wear. No, but we see God, even after man fell, he was still the one chasing after us. He still clothed them, right? And so, as I said, number three is we represent the king. And in representing the king, every single thing we read in the word applies to every area of our lives, including how we parent, including how we relate to one another. And so it's a daily work. It's a daily work of surrender. It's a daily work of waking up each morning and saying, God, help me to be more like you today. Help me to be like you. Help me to show and display your nature to my children. Help me to, you know, to do better. And doing better, remember I said in the last video, is by the power of the Spirit and by the wisdom of God. Doing better is saying, okay, is there a better way for us to pass this message? If your child maybe isn't doing something well, is there a better way to teach that child? If they're not doing something well, it may be that they just don't know how to do it. You know, sometimes what we do is we yell and scream, don't do that. But we haven't taught them how. And even if we've taught them, sometimes, yes, with children, you need to teach them over and over and over again. How many of us has God corrected several times and we heard the first time? There are many times when the Holy Spirit keeps teaching us, being patient with us, teaches us over and over again before we get some things. You know, let's give our children grace and let's be patient with them. So that's the end of today's podcast. Thank you for listening this far. If you we're blessed, please leave your comments. I'd love to hear from you. If there's anything you also want me to talk about here, please let me know. Till next time, see you. Bye.